Father, we thank you very much for this privilege. We thank you because you've called us together. We're here not by accident. We're people of purpose, and we know you have a plan for our lives. Therefore, Lord, we pray that today you'll reach out to everyone here in Jesus' name. Amen. And we pray, oh Lord, that you meet us at the point of our need. I pray you speak to me myself. And I pray you speak to everyone here too, so that none of us will go back empty-handed. Say what exactly you want us to hear and lead us into your own blessing. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Today I'm talking to you on blessing. But I'm approaching the blessing in a particular way. Again, you understand, whenever I study the Bible, I really study. And I check up the word blessing. And I discover that the word blessing was a very common word in the Old Testament. Now, you know the Bible has two parts. You will excuse my kind of mathematical approach. You have two eyes, and you have two legs, and you have two hands, and you have two kidneys and two lungs. And the Bible has two parts to you. One on the left hand side, when you open your Bible, your Old Testament will be on the left and your New Testament will be on the right. And the Old Testament has, I'll give you some figures, because how can I talk to you without giving you a feel of mathematics? I think you need it. And if you hated mathematics when you were at school, I don't know what you are going to do today. Well, you see, we have 66 books in the Bible. And 66 is 2 times 3 times 11. And that means that's a multiple of 3. And in the Old Testament, we have 39 books. That means 3 and 9. And in the New Testament, you have 27. That means 3 times 9. So if you just remember those figures, numbers 3 and 9, put one behind the other, you have 39. Multiply them, you have 27. And then you have the New Testament. But now I look at the Old Testament, and I find that in the first book of the Old Testament, I have the word blessing. I look at the last book of the Old Testament, and I find the word blessing. And that kind of attracts me. I feel that, well, if there is blessing in the first book, and there is blessing in the last book, it's talking to me about blessing from beginning to the end. And then I check up the first reference to that blessing that I checked up in the Old Testament, that's in Genesis chapter 12. It says, I will bless you. But it doesn't stop there. It says, I will make you a blessing. And when I look at that, I say, that's a promise given to an individual. I look at the last reference in the Old Testament that talks about blessing, and it says, I will pour my blessing upon you. And that's talking to a nation. And you see the progression of the blessing now is going from, I will bless you an individual, I will pour a blessing upon you as a nation. And between the individual and the nation, you have the family. And so you also have a blessing for the family. And you are here as an individual, the Lord has a blessing waiting for you. And you are here representing the nation, an official in the nation. The Lord has a blessing waiting for our nation. And you are here representing your family. The Lord has a blessing waiting for every one of our families in Jesus' name. Now, it says to the first man, that's Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. It says, I will make you a blessing. That means, I'll give you blessing, but that's not enough. I'll make you like a channel, a reservoir of blessing. And then the blessing will carry on in your life. In fact, it says the people that are associated with you, the people that blessed you will be blessed. That's saying something. It means that even the blessing will get near to your friend, will get to the people that are very close to you, very near to you. That's the confidence I have when I pray for a father. I'm able to pray for his wife, even the wife is not there, on the basis that the blessing that comes upon him will come upon his wife. That's the basis on which we can pray for the children, because you know, if the blessing is coming to the father, he is the head of the home representing the whole family, then there'll be blessing coming upon the children. And that's why I can confidently tell you, if you are blessed, your children are blessed, and your wife is blessed, and your husband is blessed. And I believe that the blessings of God will never dry up in your life in Jesus' name. And then as I look at Malachi, it says, I will pour. And from my little knowledge, what you pour must be abundant. It means that if you are going to pour that thing, it's not just a drop, it's not a trickle, it's not something at the lower part of the bucket, it's something that the Lord is going to pour upon you. And it means that it is going to overflow. In fact, in that passage, in the last reference of the blessing, it says, I will so pour the blessing upon you, you will not have enough room to be able to take the blessing. And you've not got enough yet. I believe that you'll get the blessing of the Lord in Jesus' name. Now, blessing at the beginning, blessing at the end. Then I'm asking a question. Oh Lord, if that is so, why isn't everybody blessed? Because I look at the practical, I see what's in the word of God, and I see that God is not a partial God. And I know he wants to bless everybody, but I see the practical around me, and I see that not everybody is blessed. And then I'm asking the question, oh Lord, why isn't everybody blessed? And I know it's not the fault of God, because he's a perfect God. His promises are yes and amen. And he cannot change and he will not change. He said, I have said it, will it not come to pass? I have spoken, will I not make it good? Because everything he has said, he has the power, he has the ability to make it good and to fulfill it. And then I look at the word of God and I see then that there is a condition. There is a condition for the blessing of God. And I find as I look at the word of God, the conditions are not very difficult. In fact, the conditions are almost like no condition at all. Because as I look at the word of God, I see that God commands you to do something, and then he turns around and then whispers in your ears, you just be willing, I'm the one to even carry out the command on your behalf. Because I will come and dwell in you, and I will empower you and strengthen you, and what I am telling you to do, I'm the one that will do it again through you. What he commands, he promises to effect even in our lives. And therefore you look at the conditions, and the conditions are not difficult at all, and yet the condition is there. And as the condition is there, you need to look at what the condition is, and then you make yourself available to fulfill that condition, and then I can assure you that there will be blessing for you in Jesus' name. And when I talk about blessing, I talk about all kinds of blessings. You may write it now. I have no time to read that now in Deuteronomy chapter 28, and you will find all kinds of blessings. A spiritual blessing, physical blessing, material blessing, in your social life, in your family life, everywhere you just find blessings running after you, following after you. But what then is the condition? In 2 Chronicles chapter 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, reading from verse 14, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their land, and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Here you find something that you are referring to the children of Israel to start with. You can look at the lives of the children of Israel. And if you only read the first two chapters of Judges, you'll find, because those two chapters contain a lot of generation. This generation did this, this happened, then they prayed and this happened. Cycle in their lives. And that's what you will always find as you look at history. You will find that from one generation to the other, history repeats itself. You will find, if you look at our nation here, whatever may be happening now, there is a cause, there is an effect. And it is a cause-effect kind of thing. And therefore, you will find that in your little life too, as an individual, what happens to the individual happens to the family. What happens to the family happens to the nation. You know that, for example, our science teachers will tell you, anything you want to know about a whole bucket of water, you can learn from a drop of water. Scientists will tell you that. You don't need the whole ocean to be able to tell the chemical kind of configuration on the whole ocean. Take a drop, and what you learn scientifically from that drop of water, you are going to learn about it's going to be general for all the whole ocean. And it's the same thing, that's just a specimen. And you as an individual, you are a specimen for the family, and the family representing the whole nation. And as history repeats itself in Israel, so it does in this nation, and so it does in every nation. And here is how it works in the lives of individuals. It says, if my people, that are called by my name, will humble themselves. I find that is what Israel always had to do. Whenever they had missed the blessing of God, they had to come down from the ivory tower of sin. We are Abraham's seed. And because we're Abraham's seed, automatically we ought to have the blessing. They remembered that they must humble themselves and pray and seek his face and turn from their wicked ways. And if you look at your life, it's the same thing you will find. You will find that God has a controversy with you. I deliberately use that word, very strong word, so you will know the seriousness of the matter. If I just say, well, God has a question he wants to ask you, that will be mild. If I say, God has something he's not happy with in your life, that will be true, but that will be very mild. When I say, God has a controversy with you, you wake up, you say, what? Controversy? How is it that bad? Is that bad because God hates sin? He hates evil. And experience tells you, and life tells you, and the Bible tells you, everything concurring agreeing together, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says we have sinned, and we know we have sinned. Our consciences tell us we have sinned, and because of sin, where there is sin, there is punishment. You know that at home, your little children, they do something wrong, you punish them. And you know that in the nation, somebody does something criminal, and the nation, the government, punishes such individual, or we say, the law punishes such individual. And you find that even in international circles, somebody has done something wrong, he runs to another nation. By the kind of international relationship, you will still be able to punish the crimes that people commit. And therefore, you know that punishment comes after wrongdoing. And that's a principle that God has implanted in the human nature. And God himself, he practices that. He says, we have sinned. We have gone against him. And because of that, the blessing that shall come upon our lives, he withdraws that blessing. Not because he doesn't love us, but because we don't love ourselves enough to live right and to do that which is right. But now he says, we can change this thing, we can turn it around. The blessing is still waiting for you, and I can still give you that blessing. And therefore, if my people that are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. And what does it mean when it says and pray? It means that you will go beyond yourself and you will say, yes, I know I need something from God. And I know that you are going to give this thing to me if I will talk to you and you talk to God. And that's what we're going to do when I finish very shortly. I'm going to make you to talk to God. If you are not on talking terms, I'm going to advise and counsel you that we bring a reconciliation between you and God. Why is it you are not on talking terms with God? How is it you are fighting with God? How is it that you say, no, I don't want to talk to him? You must talk to God. And talking to God means you are praying. And when you are praying to effect a reconciliation between you and God, how do you talk to him? You say, well, I'm sorry for what I did. I'm sorry I did this. I'm sorry I did that. My conscience tells me that I shouldn't have done that, but I'm sorry. And you know, the moment you say you are sorry, God says, well, that's all right then. That's all I was waiting for. Now your sins are forgiven. Now you are pardoned. And the problem will not be there again. Then he says, if you'll seek my face and turn from your wicked ways, the things you have been doing that were wicked, the things you have been doing that were not right, you will turn away from those things and then you come to the Lord. Then God says, I will forgive their sins. There is no time, but this is what I do because I love research and I love to study. And I've taken time to find out in the Bible many, many times that God said, I will. And there's one conclusion I can tell you. And I just tell you the result of the finding out in the Word of God. You know, when he was talking to Abraham, he said, I will. And you know what I've discovered? Abraham is gone now. Everything God said when he said, I will, he has done everything. There was another man. God was talking to Moses. And in talking to Moses, God said, I will. And then, he told him what he will do. Moses is gone now. Everything God said after he said, I will, I discovered he has done it now. And he was talking to David. David actually wanted to build them. A temple for the Lord. And God says, thank you very much. I will allow your son to build that, but you will not build that. In any case, because of what you said you will do, let me tell you now what I will do. And then God said, I will. And I discover that everything God said, I will unto David, he's done everything to you. And I've studied as far as Ezekiel, and many parts there God just said, I will, I will, I will. And I found out in the other parts of the Bible whether he did it or he did not. And I found out that he did. And when you come to the New Testament, there is another way in the New Testament of saying, I will. Every time Jesus said, verily, verily. That's the equivalent, New Testament equivalent of, I will. Certainly, certainly, surely, surely, without a shadow of doubt, this is what I will do. And every time God Almighty tells a human being, and he says, I will, I believe, and I know you believe, he will do it. And as we're here this afternoon, see the I will of God, he says, I will forgive their sins. Well, if that is the case, why then would you not come and talk to the Lord about it? And he says, once you come, I'll say, Lord, I'm sorry about that. I know that wasn't right. I shouldn't have gone that direction. I shouldn't have said that. And God said, that's all right. I told you I will. And even Satan cannot change my decision to forgive you. I will forgive you. And then it says, I will heal their land. Remember, this applies to the nation. Remember, it applies to the family. Remember, it applies also to the individual. And I've seen the Lord doing this. That's why when I pray, I just remember in my mind, I said, well, God said, I will heal their land. I was preaching somewhere in Britain, and one man came to me, and that's not Deeper Life. It's a Pentecostal church. We had about 2,000 ministers together, and this man came, one of the people there. He said, can you pray with me? I said, I'll gladly do that. He said, would you pray for me to for God to give me a wife? I looked at him. I said, you've never married? Oh, he said, he got married before. Oh, I said, how is it we're going to pray for another wife? Oh, he said, something happened. And I said, tell me about it. He said, I had poison in my blood. And the whole blood system in my body was poisoned. And the doctor gave me a medical report and said that this man could go anytime because the whole system is poisoned. My wife saw that, and my wife said, I can't stay with a dead man. And therefore, packed all her load and went away. And you know, I've not died yet, therefore I need another wife. Therefore, let us pray, if you can pray with me before you go back to your country, that God will give me another wife. So I said, I will pray, but can I change that prayer a little bit? He's still praying for wife, but can I pray that the other wife will come back? Oh, he said, don't waste your time and pray on that one, because there's poison in my body. And the whole system is totally poisoned. And whatever you pray here, that woman will not come back. I said, let's put I like experiment. Because, you know, that's what I've been doing all my life. I said, let's put it in a proposition of an experiment. I will pray for you that the whole blood system in your body will totally change. And then you will go to the medical doctor. Don't tell the medical doctor what happened. Just tell the medical doctor to test you. Then he will tell you what has happened. Then you tell him who has done it. And so we prayed, and he went to the medical doctor. And he said, doctor, here am I. Can you give me another test? And the doctor said, what for? Why are we wasting time? We know we already have your case history. He said, yes, let's waste a little time, even if it's just to confirm whatever it was there before, or whatever is no more there. And so the doctor was talked into it, and he made a medical report, and they examined him, every cell in his body, and he discovered that now there was no poison at all in the whole blood system. And so the doctor said, how did this happen? And then he told him, it's Jesus that has done it. And then I told him, I said, when you get that new medical report, don't do any other thing. Send it to your wife if you know the address. And he did just that. And the woman read the medical report, new medical report, and saw the signature of an authorized, qualified doctor here. And the following week, that woman packed her load and came back to the husband. And so I went the following year for that conference of their denomination. And so the man came to me after one of the messages and said, Pastor so-and-so, do you recognize me? I said, no, because I meet many people. I'm the one that came last year when you came for the conference. And I told you that my wife had gone. because of the poison in my blood. I said, yes, I remember. And he said, here is, I'm glad to introduce to you Mrs. So-and-so. And then I shook hands with the wife. I said, you are the woman, you came back, tell me about it. And she smiled and told me her own part of the testimony. You know, God is able to do all things. I said, God is able to do all things. Yes. Because he said, I will. That's what I stand upon. Well, we're in Abuja, I think it was now 1994. And this lady had carried hunchback for 34 years. And you know, I used to doubt many things when I was still under my principal, but I'm not under her, under him anymore now. I'm under another principal now, the head of the church. And the head of the church, my new principal now, he tells me that with the Heavenly Father, all things are possible. And so now I act as if I didn't go to school. When somebody has hunchback now, I say, can we pray about it? And if you have gone to school before, you don't pray about hunchback. But I just forget all that kind of a thing they pumped into me, because I've got another information now. Information from above. And it was September 1994, we're in Abuja there, and this lady had got hunchback on her back for 34 years. She had that hunchback at the age of 2. And I said, now we're going to pray. She had little running stomach, and so she put her hand on her stomach because she didn't believe that God was going to deal with hunchback. And I just said, we're going to pray for everything, goiter, hunchback, whatever it is, lay your hand there. And she didn't listen to that, but the little tummy ache, she believed that God could heal the tummy ache, but the hunchback, well, when we get to heaven, there'll be no hunchback in any way. So while we were praying, an invisible hand came and was stretching her. And then by the time we said the final amen, the hunchback had totally gone. Because God said, I will. And that I will, Satan cannot change it. We were in Zaire some few years ago, and that was my first crusade in Zaire. And while we were there, they brought a woman dying with AIDS. They brought her right from the hospital. And she was like a dry stick, very, very lean. And I tell you, the national network news of the television people, they were there that night. And while I was preaching, they stretched that woman right in front. And you talk about the power of God. And you talk about giving testimony. While you are preaching like that, and you are saying God can do anything, and God will do everything. And they say, okay, finish preaching, and you know, let's have a test case here. And so eventually we finished the message, and we didn't have time because the field we were using, the government had given us time and had said, this is the time you will close. And the Zairean there, they were telling me that we have 10 minutes more. So we really didn't have time for long prayer. But I knew God said, I will. And since God said, I will, I know you can count on that and stand on that. So I said, whatever problem you have, let us pray now. Lay your hands upon yourself. And so I said, in the name of Jesus, whatever the problem may be, you problem, I command you, get out of the place. You are healed in Jesus' name. And you know, we said amen. At that time I didn't understand French. I didn't know what the interpreter was saying. I only believed he was saying the right thing, but the people said amen. Then they told us, our time is up, our time is up. While we're going out of the field, the woman on the stretcher got up herself and was totally healed. And even the officials that said our time was up, they ran back to the field to look at the woman. Everybody ran back, and then the television network, they took everything and they relayed it to the whole nation the following day. You see, that's the power of God. And it's because God said, I will. We were in Zambia, and the president of Zambia at that time, Kaunda, it's Chiluba that is there now. And you know, I've been with Chiluba, I think, a few times too. When I first went, and Kaunda was there. And that time, if you know the philosophy of Kaunda, you know that, you know, Christianity, prayer and all that, you know that that's not his first choice. But we were there. And the newspaper two people, they were there. The television crew, they were there. I mean, television was the government. They wanted to see the, you know, the lie, the deception of all these things we're doing. And so I said, tonight, and we're giving only one day, you know.
They wouldn't give us all the 4 days we wanted. Only one day. They said, everything you want to do, one day is enough. And I said, that's all right. Take only one day. God can do in one day what men cannot do in 50 years. And so we had just the one day. And we finished the message. I said, I was going to pray for the sick now. And all those media people, they went to stand by one man. Because that man, 80 years of age, he had elephantiasis in the legs were so big he couldn't wear normal pair of trousers. And then he was also blind. And I said I was going to pray now. They didn't look at any other sick man there. All the newspaper people there, they stayed by that man. They said, today, today we will see. And you know, God likes challenge. And God was able to meet up with any challenge. And so I said, I like to start with something swollen, something visible that people will see and they will know that we are not making up anything and we are not deceiving anybody. So I started with praying for the people that have elephantiasis and whatever it is. And immediately we prayed, that thing just went down like a balloon. And the newspaper people themselves, they saw that. And I didn't know they were watching that man. It just happened that I said, the next category of people I'm going to pray for are the blind people. And he still stayed by that man. Immediately we prayed, the blind eyes just got opened. And President Kaunda knew about it and invited myself and my team to a walking luncheon the following day. And we sat down together there talking about Christ, talking about miracle, talking about wonderful, wonderful things the Lord has done. Because God said, I will, our God will never fail. You don't have any problem. Why do you think you have problem? Only Satan has problem. You have the promise of God, not a problem. And the promise of God is able to take away the problem in your life. Let me give you the last testimony and then I'll be done. Maybe I will give extra, you know. Sometimes when you are taking exam and they say choose only four of the Psalms to solve. If you solve four and you have time, maybe you can do an extra one just to know that you know what you are talking about. So I'll give you one, and if you respond properly to the one I'm giving you, I might add another one too. So we were here now in Ivory Coast. And in Ivory Coast, praise the Lord that we were reaching to Burkina Faso. And we wanted the president to even come. Well, we wanted everybody to hear the gospel. The president of Burkina Faso could not come to Ivory Coast to the crusade we were holding there. So what he did was to send the minister of religion. And the minister of religion, when we say minister of religion, you know what that means. It means somebody that knows a lot of theory but no practical. And so he came to Ivory Coast and he tendered the letter from the government of Burkina Faso. And he said, you wrote to our president, and here am I. I'm representing our president and I'm the minister of religion there. And we treated him like a minister of religion. We made him to sit on the platform every night when we had a crusade. And God did something marvelously wonderful. We were there that night, and there was a woman that had been blind for 60 years. She was blind at the age of 12. At that time, she was now 72 years of age. She was dancing at the square. And one of the villagers just went there at the age of 12, many, many years ago, and rubbed hands on her face as if she was appreciating her dancing. She went blind instantaneously. And for those 60 years, she had carried that blindness. And also, the World Health Organization officer, WHO officer, that had known about the case treating her, was also on the crusade ground that night. And also, a nephew, 35 years of age, who said that when he was born, he met Mama in that blind condition. All those people were there, and the minister of religion from Burkina Faso was on the platform. And there I was, I preached the salvation message, and then I gave the altar call. After giving the altar call and people responded, we prayed for salvation. Now I said, God said, he will forgive you. After that, he will heal the land. We're now going to pray and God will heal you. And then I said I was going to pray for the blind. And God worked it out. That woman that had been blind for 60 years, her eyes got opened. When the eyes got opened, we had enough time to give testimony. The woman came up. She was not the only one that came up. The medical doctor working with the WHO, World Health Organization, also came up to say, yes, I know this woman. And she's a case we've been dealing with. The 35-year-old man came forward and said, yes, this in our family, I know her very well. And the minister of religion from Burkina Faso was seeing all that. And so he went back to his country. And then they wrote from there and said they wanted a crusade like we had in Ivory Coast. They wanted it in Burkina Faso too. And the beauty of it in Burkina Faso is that they said that the deeper life there should not take care of my accommodation, feeding, whatever it was that the government was going to take care. And they gave all the hotel rooms. And they even gave us more hotels than the people we went with. And they said, why didn't you come with more people? Then they cleared the ground. We didn't pay for the ground. Then they cleared, they used the government caterpillar and everything to clear the ground and to make all the conveniences and everything. And then because there was a difficulty in Burkina Faso at that time, they gave us armed soldiers parading all that ground that nobody will do anything. And then at night, while I'll be sleeping in the room, there will be government soldiers with all their arms and everything in front of the door, because God said, I will. Yeah. And that I will is still working. And it is now your turn. You can put it to test and the will of God will work in your life. And you know, if you have sinned, because it's not a strange thing that you have sinned, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. He said, I will. Then he will forgive you. You will go out of this place as if you never sinned in your life. And Satan will say, he is a sinner. And God will say, I don't know about that. I look at my record, all the sins are taken away. And then you smile, you point to the devil, you are the sinner, I'm no more a sinner. And then all the promises of God will be yes and amen in your life. Do you know you can carry miracle home? I said, do you know you can carry miracle home? Why don't you rise up if you can, so we can pray together. And you talk to the Lord and say, Lord, I know there is blessing in the word of God. And that blessing is going to come upon my life. Blessing from beginning to the very end. Remember, there are two parts of the blessing. Number one, he will forgive your sin. Then number two, he will heal your land. He will give you miraculous healing. And I want to talk to you. If you know you've done something that you just know that God will not be happy about, that's not strange, that's almost like everyone. And you know you want the forgiveness of the Lord, and you want him to give you new internal strength, so that by the grace of God now, things will be totally different. I just want you to quietly raise up your hand. There will be no embarrassment for anyone. God bless you. Just raise up your hand and say, yes, I need forgiveness. I need forgiveness. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Just as you raise up your hand, just quietly tell the Lord and say, Lord, I know you are good, but I'm bad. I know you are loving, but in the past, my heart has not just manifested that kind of love towards you. I've not done right before. I've done bad before. I cannot begin to recount all the bad things I've done. But I've heard from your word that you said, I will forgive. I'm standing on that word, I will. I will. And I know you will not change. And I'm asking that you forgive me, because I believe that Jesus died for me. And that settles it. It's that simple. That settles it. Just tell the Lord, I'm sorry. You said you will forgive me. Please forgive me. I'm going to pray with you now. And you'll just accept that it's done. Because he said so. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for our beloved brothers and sisters. Thank you for the forgiveness you have given. You said you will. And neither circumstance nor Satan can change that word of certainty. Therefore, Lord, I pray that according to your promise, you forgive every sin they ever committed since they were born up till this present moment, in Jesus' name.
whisper to their hearts that you love them, that you have forgiven them, that you have cleansed them, and that because Jesus Christ bore their punishment, they will not bear that punishment again. Thank you, because I know you have done it. I know you have forgiven them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you raised up your hand, our brothers and sisters would give you a card, and you just fill that card and you return it back to the brothers, sisters distributing those cards. Now, before you go, we are going to pray that if there is any problem in your family, any problem in your life, any sickness, that the Lord will touch you and the Lord will heal you. And if the problem is not really with you, but with your wife at home, even though your wife is not here, you'll indicate on behalf of your wife. And then we will pray. And I believe the power of God will touch your wife at home. If it's your husband at home, we will pray. And the Lord will touch your husband too. Your children too, they can receive of that same blessing of the Lord. Because God said, I will, and I will not fail. So, if you have any personal problem, you'll please raise up your hand. Or if it's a friend, a neighbor, a relative, husband, wife, child, anyone, parent, having the problem, you raise up your hand and we'll pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you very much for your goodness. We thank you for your power. I bless your name because I know you will never fail. I thank you for all our brothers and sisters here who are believing you and looking up to you. And they believe that this problem will not remain. And we believe together with them, the problem will not remain. Therefore, Lord, I pray you will touch every one of them. You will deliver and heal them in Jesus' name. I pray that the curse in the life of that individual, that yoke, that curse is broken, and you are set free in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that that deformity in the life of that individual, in that family, remove it by your mighty power in Jesus' name. I pray that your healing virtue will flow right now into everyone here, and all the sicknesses, infirmities, diseases, everything will vanish away in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that a definite miraculous touch will be experienced by everyone right now. Thank you, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I believe the Lord has blessed you. Why don't you just open your eyes, and I'm through. But I promised you an extra testimony. And you know, sometimes when we pray like this, people say, what if we don't believe? Well, I don't know about that. But let me tell you this, that I went for a crusade at a meeting at Ilorin. And a university student was brought in there. And here she happened to be studying psychology. And she had one hand paralyzed. And I said, now I'm going to pray for the people that have paralysis with that hand, whatever it was. And so she said, I'm not going to allow this man to use psychology on me, because I heard he was a lecturer before at the university. Therefore, I don't want any psychology. I said, close your eyes. She said, not me. I said, lay your hand upon the place you have the problem. She said, you are not going to get me. I'm not an illiterate. And so she didn't do that. And I said, whether you believe or you don't believe, I believe. And then I prayed. And then the rest of the people that believe, we said, amen. I just said, paralyzed hand, paralyzed leg, everything, get out of the way. And the people were so excited, except herself. And so after we closed, she went back home. In the night, she had a dream. And something came out of that hand in the dream. When she woke up the following morning, that hand was like the other hand. Because whether you believe or not, God can even work miracles.